Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today. Now, I would like to explain about the cervical insufficiency. Cervical insufficiency. In our last class, we have learned about the recurrent pregnancy loss. So in the recurrent pregnancy loss, one of the cause of recurrent pregnancy loss is cervical insufficiency, which occurs in second trimester. Okay, which mostly are always it occurs in second trimester, but here this cervical insufficiency, so because I could not explain about that in the last lecture, so I thought I'll make a new lecture for it so that it becomes easier for us to understand. So what is cervical insufficiency? It is inability of the cervix, inability of uterine cervix. Cervical insufficiency is inability of the uterine cervix to retain pregnancy in second trimester. But the main criteria is here, there should not be any uterine contractions during this time. In the absence of uterine contractions, if there is inability of uterine cervix to retain the pregnancy in second trimester in the absence of uterine contractions, then we call it as cervical insufficiency. Now, congenital, what are the causes of the cervical insufficiency? The causes of the cervical insufficiency can be due to congenital, it can be a congenital condition, or it can be a cervical injury which occurs during a surgical procedure. Either due to a surgical procedure, there can be a cervical injury, or there can be a laceration in the previous pregnancy. Even this can cause a cervical injury. In such cases, the cervix which is there, that cannot hold the baby. Let me just draw the diagram. So as a result, it will cause pregnancy loss. Now, this is cervical insufficiency, where here because of the cervix which is there, this is not able to carry this baby. As a result, this can cause miscarriage at the end. Okay, now what is the history which we give? The history, it includes, painless expulsion of fetus can occur. Sometimes painless expulsion, there can be history of painless expulsion of fetus in second trimester. Okay, before there is expulsion, there can be pelvic heaviness. The woman tells that she has pelvic heaviness or pressure, or there can be profuse mucus discharge. And there is also preterm rupture of membranes. Pre-labor rupture of membranes or premature rupture of membranes. So all these can lead to painless expulsion of the fetus. So this is what happens in cervical insufficiency. Okay. Now let me tell you the causes in a diagram so that it becomes easier. Let me just show you all the causes of cervical insufficiency in a diagram, diagrammatic representation. Just a minute. So, what are the causes of cervical insufficiency? One, as you know, it is congenital. You cannot change this congenital condition, right? Then the other causes are acquired causes, which can be modified. So, these acquired conditions are, first, whenever we do forceful dilatation of cervix, It can be for any reasons. It can be for miscarriage, for whenever there is some conceptus which is present in the uterus and then you'll have to dilate it and evacuation. That can be done even in that. Or in previous surgeries, whenever there is cervical tears. So there can be cervical tears in previous surgery or in previous pregnancy, or whenever there is a lesion here in the cervix, we will do an operation which is called as conization, where you will remove this part of the cervix. So whenever we have done conization, or where we have done trachelectomy, that is removal of upper part of vagina and a small part of cervix, or if we have done fothergill surgery, or if we have done loop electro excision procedure. Okay, these are the procedures which are, this is done for cervical carcinoma in situ, cervical carcinoma in situ, and even trachelectomy and conization, it is done either for carcinoma in situ or it can also be done for first stage cervical cancer. Fothergill surgery, it is mostly done for prolapse of uterus. So based on the types of surgeries, any surgeries which are done to cervix, the surgeries may be anything, but any surgeries or any injury to this cervix that will lead to cervical incompetence. Now, what are the diagnostic features and how are you going to diagnose this cervical incompetence? Now let us learn about the diagnosis of cervical incontinence. So the cervical incontinence or cervical insufficiency, it is diagnosed by number one, speculum. If you do a per speculum examination, in the per speculum examination, you will see that the cervix is short. You will see that the cervix is short, okay? And sometimes you may also see old tears or evidence of previous surgery. It can be short, there can be short cervix or there can be evidence of previous surgery. So these should be seen on per speculum examination. Third, ultrasound diagnosis. What are you going to see on ultrasound? On ultrasound, you are going to see that the cervical length, this cervical length, it is less than 25 millimeters. That is between 16 to 24 weeks of gestation. Okay, you'll measure for cervical length between 16 to 24 weeks of gestation. Then you will see that the cervical length is less than 25 millimeters. And B, there can be funneling at internal os. I'll just draw a diagram for this funneling at internal os. If this is the os, you will see funneling of the membranes like this at the internal os. Okay, so this is seen in ultrasound. Then you can say that there is cervical incompetence. And sometimes this funneling which is there, this does not occur spontaneously, but it occurs in response to fundal pressure. Okay, so these are the different surgeries, different diagnostic features which are important in cervical incompetence. Now, how are we going to treat the cervical incompetence? For cervical incompetence, the treatment of cervical incompetence or cervical insufficiency is one, it is called a cerclage. We do a cerclage. For treating the cervical incontinence, we'll have to do the cerclage. There are different types of cerclage which are available. So before going into the different types of cerclage based on the surgery, first we will learn about the indications of cerclage. Cerclage indications, they are classified into four types. One, history induced cerclage. So here it is for women between 12 to 14 weeks of gestation. Here, if it is done, if history is suggestive of cervical incompetence, here only based on history we can give cerclage treatment. No tests are done here. Okay, that is history-induced cerclage. The second type is ultrasound-indicated cerclage. Now, in this type, the ultrasound has indicated it. We are not doing it based on history. This is done between 14 to 24 weeks of gestation. Okay, here on ultrasound you will see that here the cervical length is less than 25 centimeters, which is before 24 weeks. Before 24 weeks you will see that the cervical length is less than 25 centimeters. In such case there is an increased chance of pregnancy loss and also sometimes preterm labor, and as a result we give the treatment of cerclage. Then sometimes you can also give it whenever there is physical examination which is indicated cerclage. If you have done a physical examination and if that indicates cerclage, then what does that mean? It is performed at 16 to 28 weeks of gestation. And this is done if in the physical examination, if you have seen that the cervix which is there, the cervix is more than 1 centimeter dilated, and if you have also seen that the membranes are ruptured, in such cases you will put a cerclage. So if that is the main indication of the cerclage, then we call it as a physical examination induced cerclage, indicated cerclage. Now the final term is, final type, final indication is emergency cerclage. So what are the emergency cerclage? These are indicated if diagnosis was not suspected earlier, either in physical examination or in history or ultrasound. But the woman will, this can occur at any gestational age, but the woman here will present with cervix which is dilated to more than 4 centimeters and there are bulging membranes. Here the cervix is dilated to more than 4 centimeters and there are bulging membranes. So as a result, this can cause preterm labor. Okay, sorry, the cervix is dilated to less than 4 centimeters. Okay, less than 4 centimeters. Now what are the contraindications in emergency cerclage? Let us learn the contraindications of cerclage. Whenever there is emergency, what are the contraindications of cerclage? If the cervix is dilated to less than 4 centimeters, sorry, more than 4 centimeters. If it's dilated to less than 4 centimeters and if there are bulging membranes, then it's okay. You can do emergency cerclage. But if the cervix is dilated to more than 4 centimeters and if there is rupture of membranes or if there is evidence of infection. In such cases, you cannot do a cerclage. Okay, so these are the different treatment options. These are different indications of the treatment of cerclage, which is the treatment of cervical incontinence. Now, let us learn about the procedures of cerclage now. So, procedures, there are mainly two types of procedures. The first type is transvaginal procedure. That is transvaginal cerclage. So in this transvaginal cerclage, you will just do cerclage procedure transvaginally. The second type is transabdominal cerclage. So in this transabdominal cerclage, you are doing it by an incision. Okay, that is transabdominal cerclage. So transvaginal is again of two types, which is McDonald's procedure. The second type is Schrodinger's procedure. The first type is McDonald's procedure and the second type is Schrodinger's procedure. In McDonald's procedure, it is the procedure of choice. McDonald's procedure is the procedure of choice. So this procedure is done under general or spinal anesthesia. And what are we going to do in this procedure? In this procedure, the patient is placed in dorsal lithotomy position and the lips of the cervix which are there, they are held with a sponge holding forceps. And then you will just suture through the substance of the cervix. A purse string suture is placed over the cervix. Okay, so if you see, I'll just I think I'll just draw a diagram for this so that it becomes easier for us to understand. So in McDonald's procedure, now this is the uterus and this is the cervix, right? Now what we do is, to this cervix we will suture it here. Okay, this suture we will call as purse string suture. It is a purse string suture. I'll just show you how you will do it in cross section. If this is the cross section of this suture, if this is the cervix and these are the ends of the cervix. Now what we do is, okay, now we will pass our suture material. Okay, now we will pass our suture material here. This is the cervix and this is the opening of the cervix. Now you will pass our suture material like this. Okay, one, and then you will just bring it out, and then you will pass it like this, and you'll bring it out, and then you'll pass it like this, and then you'll bring it out like this, and then you'll pass it inside, and then you'll bring it out. Okay, so this type of suture is called as purse string suture. Now on if you just bring it closely, then you will see the something like this. You will see that it looks something like this. Okay, so this is called as purse string suture, and you will see the sutures, which are only these sutures which are coming out like this. Okay, so this type of suture is called as purse string suture. So this purse string suture is applied over the cervix. So as a result, the cervix is now held a little tightly with this suture. Okay, so this suture is removed at 38 weeks. So later the suture, it is removed at 38 weeks of gestation. So this is about the McDonald's procedure. Now the second type of procedure is Shirodker's procedure. It is the indication of this Shirodker's procedure is if this is given in women with previous failed McDonald's procedure. Whenever there is previous failed McDonald's cerclage, in such cases you can do this procedure. In this procedure, the bladder is dissected up. So here what do we do is, the bladder which is there, that is dissected up, and now the suture is placed at the level of internal os. And then we will there is a tape which is called as Marceline tape, and this tape is used and it is passed around the cervix. So let me just show you the diagram. So if this is the cervix and this is the os, then what we do is, we will just first and foremost, we will just suture it. Okay, we will apply a suture at the level of internal os. First you will apply a suture here, and then you will pass a tape that is called as Marceline tape, is passed around the cervix. This is the cervix, right? This Marceline tape is passed around the cervix like this, so that it is stiffer. Okay, so here one, you're suturing it. So in Shirodker's procedure, we will suture at internal os. That is one thing. And second, we will pass a Marceline tape. We'll pass a Marceline tape around the cervix. So this will stop the cervix from coming out. So these are the different procedures which are available for cerclage procedures. And one more is, we can also do it in transabdominal way. So these are the different procedures which are available for treating cervical insufficiency or cervical incompetence. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.